She burps.
Walk, boy, don't run.
She fancied it.
Right, bags up. Settle down.
School's telly's coming up.
What have we got this afternoon, sir? Zed Cars or Crossroads?
Your favourite, Murphy, English literature. And do me a favour, will you? Get the right books out this time.
Who's missing?
Marty.
Oh, I might have guessed.
He went home for his nosh.
So far, we have looked at the satire of Jonathan Swift in two ways. First, we examined his method of dealing with the world of letters, and we saw how his style was literary and full of echoes of works he had read. Then, we looked at Swift and the world of politics in London and Dublin, when he acted and wrote as the supporter of a party. Now we're going to turn to his most famous work, Gulliver's Travels. And we shall see that here, he was no longer content to write only for his audiences in London or Dublin, but aimed at a much wider readership. In fact, he told the French translator of Gulliver that he hoped the book would be understood not only abroad, but that he was convinced that it would also have some value for posterity. The book is the product of his years of maturity and disillusionment, and was published anonymously at the end of October 1726. It was an immediate success.
Come on, sir.
Need a screwdriver, sir?
Very interesting.
Hey, sir, we haven't paid for the television license.
Open.
Redlow Comprehensive, I have a message for you. I'm talking to you, the youth of today, the citizens of tomorrow. You and the upper six will soon embark on those vital examinations that will determine your future. To whom does this future belong? What is Redlow School? Is it just a place you go to each day to study for examinations? Or does it perhaps serve some other purpose? Have you ever considered the possibility that your presence at school could be used to great advantage? Question and answer. How well do you know your teaching staff? Who and what are they? Can you trust them? Question and answer. Who is this man? I call John Harvey, teaching English literature for A-levels, but is that all? Question and answer. All over the world, your generation is demanding answers to questions. Who and why? Question and answer. I am the voice of truth.
What about that? What a pity, sir, just as it was getting to the juicy bits.
Question and answer, sir.
You're all right, now calm down, will you?
Naughty, naughty, sir. Now, what have you been getting up to that we don't know about?
Very interesting.
Well, did you hear what I said?
I suppose we cut the tomfoolery and get on with some work, huh?
What's up, sir? It was only a joke, wasn't it?
The voice of truth. At least it's a change from the voice of art.
I think we should inform the Board of Governors, let them take it up with the television company who put out that broadcast.
Oh no, surely it was someone just having a bit of fun with school's television.
May I remind you, Miss Walker, the interruption of educational television is an offence under the Post Office Act. My view is we should telephone the police at once.
Surely.
Oh, I think that's probably a little extreme, Fletcher. After all, no real harm's been done, has it?
The upper six are in their final week before taking A-levels. It could be most prejudicial.
Well, it's probably just some ham TV operator. I think you ought to forget about the whole thing. Treat it as a practical joke.
Yeah, well, you might feel slightly different about it, Elliot, if it had been your photo that flashed up on the screen.
I'm amazed you're so sensitive, Mr. Harvey. Knowing your popularity amongst the six formers, I'd have thought you'd be flattered.
I still think it would be most dangerous. Six formers have minds of their own. It doesn't take much incitement to cause trouble these days.
Absolute rubbish. The lot I've got are very down to earth.
You're not suggesting there are any political undertones in that broadcast, are you, Mr. Fletcher?
I don't think I need detain you any longer. I'm sure you all want to get home. Mr. Harvey, could you spare me just a couple of minutes? I want to go over the arrangements for the exam.
Certainly, Headmaster.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night, Headmaster.
Voice of truth. Question and answer. What does it mean?
I don't know. But somebody's onto us.
Like to me.
Bust up your bike? What are you talking about?
I told you, some maniac ran into me. Hit and run, he could have killed me. Damage to the front wheel, I should get it fixed.
Look, have you any idea how much that bike cost me?
You have told me quite a few times.
Money don't grow on trees, you know. I have to earn every penny I make.
All right, Dad, you don't have to keep dropping hints. I know I'm not earning my keep.
Well, I didn't say that, did I?
No, but you meant it. What would you like me to do? Shall I rob a bank or something?
All I want you to do is to take care of things that cost money. How did it happen?
I told you, hit and run.
Well, did you take down his number?
Look, Dad, for the last time, I don't expect you to pay for the damage to the bicycle. I will with my pocket money, which I...
Look, if it was somebody else's fault, we ought to get him. You've got no sense of responsibility. That's your trouble. I don't know what's the matter with you. I can't even have a sensible conversation with you.
I can tell you why, because you always row.
It's only your future I'm thinking of. You're all I've got now. And I owe it to you, Mother. Where are you going?
Out.
What about your own work?
I'll do it when I get back.
Look, you've got to get through these exams next week, you know. You can't put them off again. Martin.
Well, what about your tea? Shall I put something in the oven for you?
No. Oh, it's okay, Dad. If I want something, oh, I'll get it later.
Jerry, if only you weren't so unreasonable.
All right, Jane, if you're not even prepared to talk to me.
It's not that. Look, let's go inside. I can't afford to seem to be able to.
Mister.
I'm afraid it is, not a vintage year.
You nearly killed me this morning. You knocked me off my bike.
I'm most awfully sorry about that. I assure you it was an accident. Getting a little short-sighted. I'm sure I need spectacles.
I'll say you need spectacles. Have you seen what you've done to my bike?
Good Lord, did I do that? How very responsible of me. Oh, you must let me pay for the damage. Here. Now, come on, take it. It was my fault, wasn't it? Hmm?
Why are you, mister? Why are you following me?
Following you? It was a slight exaggeration, I should say.
This is the third time I've seen you today. You were hanging around outside the school. Why?
Oh, dear. I wouldn't make a very good private detective, would I?
Who are you?
My name is Forrester. I want to have a little talk with you.
It's not my fault. I do have some duties to fulfill, you know.
Like meeting that American sergeant from the base every evening.
Any objection?
Yes, every objection.
You don't own me.
Jane, for heaven's sake. You can't simply ignore what's happened.
No. All right, Jerry, what do you want me to do?
Leave the young standing and come out with me. Let's walk up to Beacon's Edge, shall we? Come on, darling, it's a lovely evening.
I'm sorry, I can't do that.
Tomorrow?
We'll see. Jerry, be patient, please.
Fantastic, yes, I suppose it is, really. I'm afraid it's true, Martin. Someone at Redlow Comprehensive School is a traitor.
Traitor? To who? To what?
Well, to a thing we hold in respect, I suppose. Free? Oh, dear. That's what I get for not putting on a scarf. I shall suffer for this.
What you're really trying to say is just because some of our blokes are different, because we want to think for ourselves, you call us traitors.
No, I don't deny anybody the right to think for themselves. It's only when they try to force their opinions on others.
What's all this got to do with me?
I need your help, Martin.
My help?
I'm looking for a troublemaker, perhaps some kind of political agitator. Someone who's using Redlow School as a cover for espionage activities.
Espionage?
That amuses you.
Espionage in this village.
There's an American airbase 2 miles away.
Look, mister, the only thing people around here are interested in is jam making and the annual village fete. I knew you were a phony the first time I saw you. Know nothing about spying.
Oh, but I do. Martin Clifford. 18 next birthday, studying English, chemistry and history for A-levels. Your mother died preventing you sitting them in June. You live in one of the old mill cottages with your father, who works as an unskilled labourer at the American Air Force Base. You two don't get on too well together. But you do have a close friend, Kenneth Murphy, better known as Spud. You're both interested in photography. Is that right?
Who are you, mister? What do you want?
Who's the voice of truth, Martin?
I don't own anything. I don't know what you're talking about.
Who are the spies, Martin? The traitors who stop at nothing to disrupt our way of life. Oh, the English countryside has never been the same since all that happened, has it? Screaming all over our skies, bursting out of your drums. There's an awful lot of people who'd like to stop that noise for one reason or another. Well, I must hang around about here. The damage is bad for my rheumatism.
Well, look, just because there is an Air Force base near the village doesn't mean we're all a bunch of spies, does it? Well, if you know so much, tell me who these so-called traitors are and what do they want?
That, Martin, is something you will find out for me.
Oh.
How's things?
Hello, Michael. All the better for seeing you. You know how things are Redlow Comprehensive?
Oh, you know, it survives.
Oh, yeah.
Cheers. Hey,
excuse me.
Yeah, sure.
Murphy!
Oh, hello, sir. Fancy seeing you here. You know Sally, don't you?
You are a couple of nits, aren't you? You know this place is out of bounds.
There's nowhere else to go, Mr. Mark.
That doesn't mean you have to go boozing in pubs.
Boozing? Glass of shandy and a peg of crisps.
Mine's a ginger beer, made out of washing up liquid.
You are not allowed to buy alcohol in a pub.
They didn't buy it. I did.
I ask you to keep yourself to yourself in future, Mr. Elliot. The sixth formers are my responsibility, not yours.
What's all the fuss about? In a few weeks' time, they'll be leaving school. They can do what they like then.
Look, Spud. Don't be a fool, mate. Don't make me have to call Mr. Dessel.
Oh, come off it, sir. Be a sport. Sit down and join us.
Yeah, run.
All right, lad. Come on, out. You too, young lady.
Ah, come on, sir. We've got a date with Alcoholics Anonymous.
I don't want any more of your nonsense, Murphy. You've already failed your A-levels once. If I hear you've been in a public house again, I'll have your parents over here. Suspended from football till the end of term. And now get out of here.
Yes, sir.
What did he say?
I'm sorry about that, Spud. Desmond phoned Mr. Brooks.
Hi, Ann.
We've got to watch them. They're getting restless. Brooks has laid me off football for the rest of the term. Hey, Mark, that television thing yesterday. Well, at first I thought it was just a gag, the same as everybody else. But now I'm not so sure. Who is Brooks, anyway?
Yes? Brooks speaking. You fool. I told him never to call me here. Are you sure? When I sent that pigeon off last night, it must have got there. Well, no, leave it all to me. I'll see to it. What? Well, what about him? Well, of course he's a pupil at the school. He's in the upper sixth. Are you quite sure? No, all right, leave it to me. I'll attend to it.
Now on, you have to obey every instruction you receive. Every move you make will be watched. You're on trial.
Sorry, sir. I don't know what you're talking
I've
about.
I've found out how they've done it. Here, this coaxial conjunction box in here.
Oh, you mean that television broadcast, The Voice of Truth?
It's only a hunch. But if anything happens to me, you'll find it in my office.
Well, Farmer, what's going to happen to you?
It's up to you now, Martin. It's your future you have to defend.
Don't trust anyone.
Thank you.
All right, settle down, everyone.
He's late again, miss.
Good afternoon. Our first program this afternoon is advanced chemistry for A-level pupils.
Thank you.